Right, so people, we will continue with the human heart part. Okay, human heart, as we have seen, is one of the very complex organs, but at the same time very important as well. So in the previous slides we have seen how the evolution of heart has happened, from how it evolved from the fishes. So in the fishes we had a tubular structure, and if you notice, the auricles were downwards and the ventricles were upwards. Okay, so the ventricles were upward and the auricles were downwards, and it was a tubular structure, and it was into single circulatory system. It is not a double circulatory system. Then we went to the heart of amphibians and reptiles, and we saw how the ventricles went lower and the auricles went on the upper side. Okay, so yes, human heart also has almost the same structure, but we have to understand, when we are talking about the human heart, the ventricles have actually, so it is an evolutionary form in which the ventricles have gone down and the auricles have gone up. So that's the human heart structure. Okay, so it is, we all know that it is a muscular pumping organ concerned with pumping the oxygenated as well as deoxygenated blood. The deoxygenated blood needs to go into the lungs for purification, and the oxygenated blood obviously needs to go into the body. Located in the medius venum. Medius terum means this is basically the central part in the chest or thoracic cavity. We can call this as medius terum. So it is above the diaphragm. We all know it is above the diaphragm, somewhat between the two lungs. So it is between the two lungs, and there is a depression in the left lung which accommodates the heart. Okay, so it fits in the cardiac notch. We call this as cardiac notch, basically a depression in which the heart's in which the heart fits, and this depression is in the left lung. So this is the cardiac notch, and this depression is in the left lung where it gets fit. Okay, the size of the human heart, if we look into it, everybody will have a different size altogether. So there is no size for a human heart, but it will depend upon the person's body. So if we close this fist, this will be the approximate size, the closing fist. Okay, so if a tight fist is basically the size of human heart. Okay, this shape is basically in the form of a triangle. This shape is basically in the form of a triangle, and an inverted triangle to be very precise. So as we know, the evolution has happened from the fishes to the mammals. Okay, so in the fishes it was the other way around, whereas in mammals it has gone the other way around. The auricles have gone up and the ventricles have come down. Okay, so this is basically a triangular shape. So the upper part is still known as the base. Why will we call the upper part as base? Because we started with fishes in which the auricles were downwards. Okay, so that's the reason we still call it a base. And this is known as the apex. So this is known as the apex. Okay, now what about the weight? So it is slightly different in males and females. In females it is approximately from 280 males it is 280 to 300 grams, slightly heavier, and in females it is 230 to 280 grams. Okay, heart is purely a mechanical organ. Okay, so it is only concerned with pumping of blood. All right, so now we have basically the base part here, and we have, okay, now the heart has got many depressions. Okay, depressions means places where it is, you know, reducing in size. So this is basically the base part of the heart. This is basically the base part of the heart, and this is, as we all know, is the apex. Okay, it comes slightly towards the left side. The apex comes slightly towards the left side, or we can say that the narrow end of the heart is slightly displaced towards the left, and that's how it gets adjusted in the cardiac notch which is there in the lungs. Okay, so there is this first depression is that of coronary sulcus. Coronary sulcus basically is auricular ventricular separation. So the auricular ventricular separation is the coronary sulcus, and we have the separation between two ventricles as well, and this is known as interventricular sulcus. So there is a coronary sulcus and there is an interventricular sulcus as well. Okay, so this is enclosed in a double walled membranous sac, and that is known as pericardium. So that's how the heart would look externally. It would appear to have two depressions. Okay, one separating the auricles and the ventricles, and that is known as the coronary sulcus. Sulcus basically means a depression. Okay, sulcus will basically mean a depression. And the ventricular, interventricular sulcus, which is basically separating the right and the left ventricle. So, although we say that the human body is symmetrical, but heart is not perfectly symmetrical. Okay, you will have these depressions and you will have a slight tilt towards the left. So, it is not perfectly symmetrical. Okay, however, when we represent it in diagrams of auricles and ventricles, it more or less looks symmetrical. But these are certain depressions which are there. Okay, so this is pretty much the external features of the heart. Now we'll go into the internal features. Okay. Okay, so we have basically got the heart's external structure out here, and how are these important. Okay, so external structure, basically we have seen that there is a coronary sulcus, that is a transverse groove present between the aorta and the ventricles. So we have seen it's like this. Okay, so between the auricles and the ventricles is this coronary sulcus. Sulcus basically again means a depression. So on the ventricles there are two grooves. One is anterior interventricular sulcus, so this is basically from the front end. Okay, so we will have the anterior interventricular sulcus, and from the back end we will have the posterior interventricular sulcus. So we have two depressions or grooves in the human heart. One is between the upper part and the lower part, that is the auricles and the ventricles, and that is known as the coronary sulcus. That is basically the groove. And between the ventricles and the auricles we have the interventricular sulcus. So one is obviously from the front end, and that is known as the anterior interventricular sulcus, and one is from the back end, that is known as the posterior interventricular sulcus. So these sulcuses are basically grooves that we see from the external part of the heart. If we are looking from the external end, these depressions would be very clearly visible to us. Okay, now wall of the heart, there is one epicardium, which is the outer wall, then there is one myocardium, which is the middle wall, and there is one endocardium, which is basically the inner wall. So let's look at the heart structure. This is how it will appear. So there is an inner wall that is known as the endocardium. If you look at it, this will be the inner wall, that is in the endocardium, and this is made up of simple squamous epithelium. Okay, then we have the epicardium, and then we have the myocardium. This myocardium is basically made up of all types of cardiac muscles, and this is very thick and muscular. Okay, the myocardium, the middle part, is basically very muscular. It is made up of all cardiac muscles. Now when we come to the epicardium, so endocardium is made up of simple squamous epithelium. When we come to the epicardium, which is basically this part, okay, the outermost part, it is made up of serous pericardium and fibrous pericardium. So it is made up of serous pericardium and fibrous pericardium. So this is basically if you look into it, there will be a first layer. Let me put it through a different, this layer, that is the first layer from the myocardium as we are going out. Okay, that is known as visceral pericardium. The first layer that we encounter for the epicardium as we move on from the myocardium is known as the visceral pericardium. So the inner one from the heart is known as visceral pericardium, and as we move out, the outer one is known as parietal pericardium. So this is known as the parietal pericardium, visceral and parietal. So these are the two layers. Okay, now these two make the serous pericardium. So the serous pericardium is basically made up of the visceral and parietal. We have something in between as well, which we will discuss. So in between we have the pericardial fluid. So in between we have the pericardial fluid, and the normal volume here is approximately 15 milliliters. So we have the pericardial fluid. What is its function? It acts as a lubricant. If you see, it acts as a lubricant because the heart has to constantly work as a pumping organ. So it is a pump, so it will need a lubricant as well. So this pericardial fluid acts as a lubricant, and it protects the heart from mechanical shocks as well. So it's a shock absorber as well. So it works both ways. So we have the visceral pericardium, pericardial fluid, and the parietal pericardium, which are all making up the serous pericardium. Now, as we saw, outside there is fibrous pericardium. So this is basically the fibrous pericardium that we have outside. Okay, it's fibrous tissues. So it is fibrous pericardium. Okay, now this serous pericardium, both are made up of simple squamous epithelium. So here also we have simple squamous epithelium, and in visceral and pericardial layers also we have simple squamous epithelium. So this is pretty much the internal walls of the heart. So this is we can say the walls of the heart. So walls of the heart again are made up of epicardium, myocardium and endocardium. Endocardium is the innermost layer made up of simple squamous epithelium. Myocardium is the thickest layer and is made up of highly specialized muscles. Okay, because the primary function of the heart is to pump, so it will need a good layer of muscles, and that is basically the myocardium part. Endocardium, that is the last part here as we go going out. Okay, so it has got two layers. One is serous pericardium. Serous pericardium is made up of visceral pericardium, the first layer. Then we have the pericardial fluid, which helps in lubrication as well as shock absorption. And then we have the outermost layer, which is known as the peritial pericardium. All these three make up the serous pericardium. Then we have the fibrous tissue, which is known as fibrous pericardium. And both of these, serous pericardium and if you look endocardium, both are made up of squamous epithelium, simple squamous epithelium. Okay, so this is pretty much the wall of the heart and what are basically the grooves or the depressions. We will talk more about the internal structure of the heart. Okay, so we saw the external structure of the heart and we saw where we have depressions or grooves, which are particularly very important, the coronary grooves and all those grooves we have seen. Now we'll go into the internal structure of the heart. So it's a complex organ, obviously a lot of things would be there, so a high attention level is required, and very self-explanatory processes are there, so we will understand it in bits and pieces. Okay, so here is what we have as a structure of human heart. Okay, so we are going to study the internal structure of human heart. So as we see in fishes, we had the heart in such a way that it was basically, in fishes it was a tubular structure. It was a tubular structure in which the auricles were down and the ventricles were up. The ventricles were up and the auricles were down. Okay, so auricles had a downward position, the ventricles an upward position. So as we evolved into amphibians and then reptiles and then finally into mammals, so then the ventricles went down and the auricles went up. So as the evolutionary stage happened, or the evolution happened, it the heart got reversed. Okay, so in the same way it is, so we still consider the heart in this way, that this is basically the base part. This is basically the base part and this is the apex part. So obviously the base part is much wider and thicker, much wider than the apex part. Okay, so from the fishes to the mammals, the evolution of heart has happened upside down. Okay, so now wall of the left ventricles are the thickest. Okay, so let's understand this first the diagram here. So here we have the four chambered heart. Here it is the left, this one is the left auricle, obviously this one is the right auricle. We can call this as atrium, left atrium and right atrium. So similarly we will have right ventricle and, sorry, this will be left ventricle, this will be left ventricle and this will be right ventricle. Okay, all right, so these are basically the auricles and ventricles, very self-explanatory, the four chambered heart. Okay, so now in between them there is a division. So there is a proper four chamber division, no mixing of blood should happen. So this is called the interventricular septum. So this is basically separating the ventricles. Okay, so this is known as the interventricular septum, and the similar way the auricles are separated by interauricular septum. So we have interventricular septum separating the ventricles and we have interauricular septum separating the auricles. Now in the interauricular septum, in the interauricular septum somewhere here we have a slight depression. okay, the membrane becomes slightly thinner out here. The septum becomes thinner. Why? Because it is this portion or the depression is known as fossa ovalis. Why is it known as fossa ovalis, or what function and why is there a depression? Because it is the remains of foramen ovale. Now, when the child, we know, is in the mother's womb, so this passage is actually open. This passage is open. So intermixing of blood happens. If you recall, we do not have a child. When the child development takes place in the embryonic stage, they don't breathe. There is no lungs for them. The lungs are not functional. Okay. So obviously they won't have any oxygenated blood. So obviously whatever blood is getting supplied to them is through the mother. So they will not have an oxygenated blood. So what is the purpose of having a separation? The separation purpose here is the deoxygenated blood pours in from here, from the entire body, and the oxygenated blood pours in into here from the lungs. So the intermixing of blood should not happen. But in a child who is in an embryonic stage, there is no oxygenated blood separately that is getting manufactured by any inhaling of oxygen, because the lungs are not functional. Okay. So since the lungs are not functional, we have a hole. Now the hole should actually be covered up at the time of birth. If it doesn't get covered up, then there is an intermixing of blood that will happen, and this is because both the chambers are receiving different sorts of blood. This is receiving the deoxygenated blood and this is receiving the oxygenated blood. So the intermixing of blood will happen. That's the reason we will, you might have heard somebody known to you that person has a hole in the heart. So hole in the heart means this portion is not covered. Okay, hole in the heart means this. So the fossa ovalis is basically the remains of foramen ovale. Okay. Now, as we see, the wall of the left ventricles, if you notice, are the thickest. In fact, the walls, if you notice, the walls of the right and left auricles are almost the same. The right ventricle, it goes thicker, and the left ventricle, it is the thickest. So if you see this portion, this is the thickest, and in fact the walls of the walls left ventricle is almost 3 times thicker than the right ventricle. Why is there a difference in the thickness? See, thickness means more muscles. Okay, we have seen that the walls of the heart are made up of 3 layers, out of which this is basically the muscle layer. So the thicker the wall is, the more muscular it will be. And try and understand this. See, auricles have lesser thickness because auricles have to just pump the blood into the respective ventricles. So the right auricle or the right atrium will pour the deoxygenated blood into the right ventricle. Similarly, the right left auricle or atrium will pour the blood into the left ventricle. Okay, so they just have to ensure that the blood drops down here, not much of a distance to be covered. Now coming to right ventricle, what will it do? It will pour or it will push the blood, pump the blood to the lungs, a nearby organ to the heart. So again, not much required, but still much higher than the auricles. Pumping should be with much of a force than the auricles. So it is to a larger distance all the way up to the lungs. So this right ventricle has walls thicker than both the auricles. Now coming to left ventricle, this left ventricle has to pump blood to the aorta, which is supplied to all the organs of the body. So this has to be by default the thickest, okay, because it is pumping blood to the entire body structure. Okay, so that's the reason left ventricle is almost 3 times thicker than the right ventricle. Okay, all right, so this was about the ventricular structure. What else do we have? Okay, now let's look at what and where is the blood coming in. So let's look at the right auricle. Now this right auricle has deoxygenated blood coming in. We all have studied somewhere or the other. There is a superior vena cava. This is basically the superior vena cava, and there is an inferior vena cava, which is also known as post caval. This is known as precaval. Okay, the superior vena cava is bringing in blood from the upper part of the body, deoxygenated blood from the upper part of the body into the right atrium. Inferior vena cava is bringing in deoxygenated blood from the lower part of the body into this. Now imagine the entire body has been covered, the body parts upper from the heart and the body parts lower from the heart. What about the heart itself? Okay, so heart is also an organ. It will also need oxygenated blood, and if it needs oxygenated blood, definitely it will manufacture deoxygenated blood. Where is its deoxygenated blood going to go? So here is where we have a coronary sinus. Now this coronary sinus carries blood from the heart wall into the heart itself. That's the reason it is known as coronary sinus. So obviously heart is an organ. It will have its own requirements as other organs and cells and tissues in our body have, and it will fulfill its requirements in the same way. So it will accept oxygenated blood and it will generate deoxygenated blood. This deoxygenated blood which is generated is poured into the right atrium through the coronary sinus. Sorry. So this coronary sinus is pouring in deoxygenated blood from the, okay. Now see, when the deoxygenated blood is getting collected here, okay, the auricles are also contracting. Now when they are contracting, there is a very high possibility that this deoxygenated blood will go into these blood vessels back. Okay, so to prevent the backflow of blood, we should have proper walls. So to prevent the backflow of blood, there are proper walls in both these things, that is the coronary sinus and the inferior vena cava. So the inferior vena cava, we have the valve of Eustachius, and in the coronary sinus we have the valve of Tabacius. Okay, so valve of Tabacius in the coronary sinus prevents the backflow of blood due to auricular contraction, backflow of deoxygenated blood. And in this inferior vena cava, because then the purpose will be defeated. If the same deoxygenated blood which has traveled all the way from the organs to the heart to get oxygenated blood, the purpose will be defeated because again the deoxygenated blood is going back into them. So there are valves here which prevent the backflow of the blood, and these valves in the coronary sinus are known as valves of Tabacius and valve of Eustachius. Okay, now you must be wondering why there is no valve here. Okay, so there is a reason why there is no valve here. See, this is basically the entry. This is the superior vena cava coming from the upper part of the body, and it enters like this into the heart. It enters like this at a particular angle into the heart. Now when there is auricular contraction, when the auricles are contracting, it automatically gets closed. So it would not need a separate valve for preventing the backflow of blood. It is at such an angle that it gets closed like this. The moment the blood is poured in, the auricular contraction happens, because now the auricles have to send blood to the ventricles. So the auricular contraction will happen, and when the auricular contraction happens, it automatically gets closed. It will not need a separate valve for its closure. Okay, so that's pretty much about the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Okay, now we have, I hope there will be a lot of covering that needs to be done in terms of labeling a heart diagram. We are yet to cover what happens in the right section, that is the left section, the left auricles and the left ventricles. So the reason why I have not mentioned it, because there will be a lot of confusion. So we'll deal in bits and pieces. So first let's cover this. So the wall of the heart, what is it made up of? It is made up of cardiac muscle fibers. It is made up of connective tissues and tiny blood vessels. Okay, so the fibers branch and cross connect with each other, forming a complex net like arrangement. We call this as Purkinje fibers. We'll discuss about this later. So there is a complex network of fibers, okay, and there is a complex net. This facilitates the constriction waves to pass quickly through the heart chamber. So the constriction waves that are generated, it is properly passed through the entire heart chambers. These are basically known as Purkinje fibers, and we will talk about them. So the heart wall is basically made up of cardiac muscle fibers, connective tissues and tiny blood vessels. The fibers branch and cross connect with each other, forming a dense network or complex net like arrangement, and this facilitates the constriction waves. The waves which are generated due to the contraction of the ventricles or the contraction of the auricles, they are completely passed on throughout the heart chamber. Okay, so we will talk about the right portion. Okay, so we are going to continue with the diagram of the heart. We saw that there were certain things which we had not covered in the previous diagram. So the things that we are going to cover now. Okay, so in the right or rather the left atrium, we will be receiving oxygenated blood from the lungs. So there are pulmonary veins. Now understand, anything which brings blood to the heart is known as veins, and anything which carries blood away from the a blood vessel which basically brings blood into the heart is known as veins, and a blood vessel which carries blood away from the heart is known as an artery, irrespective of whether it is oxygenated or deoxygenated blood. If you go by the concept of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood, then we will get confused how to name a pulmonary artery and how to name a pulmonary vein, because generally the aorta is carrying that oxygenated blood from the heart, and the veins, that is the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava or the coronary sinus, are carrying deoxygenated blood to the heart. But if you look into it, pulmonary veins are carrying oxygenated blood to the heart, whereas pulmonary artery is carrying oxygenated blood away from the heart. So the way in which, or the pattern in which arteries or veins are named, is not as per oxygenated or deoxygenated blood, but as per the direction of the blood flow, whether it is carrying blood to the heart or whether it is carrying blood away from the heart. So a blood vessel which carries blood away from the heart is known as an artery, and a blood vessel which carries blood into the heart is known as a vein. So we will quickly look into this. Now, since we have two lungs, there will be two veins which are carrying blood from the right lung and the left lung and pouring the blood all the way up to the left atrium. So these are basically two vessels which we see. These are known as pulmonary veins. So total there are four in number, two from the left and two from the right, two from the left lungs and two from the right lungs. So these are pouring basically oxygenated blood from the lungs into the right left atrium. Now what happens is this blood goes into the left ventricle. Okay, again we had missed on one thing. We have valves here. Between the auricles and the ventricles, there are valves. See, deoxygenated blood comes here, and also the oxygenated blood comes here, but there should not be any backflow, okay? Because the ventricles are going to contract, and this contraction is with a huge force. So if this contraction happens, the purpose of left ventricle contraction is to pump the blood into the aorta so that it can be supplied to all the body organs, and the purpose of right ventricles is to contract and supply the blood or carry the deoxygenated blood to the lungs. So the ventricles are definitely contracting, and contracting with a huge force. So there is a very high possibility, in fact it will happen, that the blood from here goes again back to the auricles, the blood from here again goes back into the auricles. So here, in order to prevent that, we have valves, and these are basically of two types. So between the left auricle and the left ventricle, we have a valve which is known as the right auriculoventricular valve. So this is basically auriculoventricular valve. So in the right portion, we have right auriculoventricular valve, and the left portion we have left auriculoventricular valve. Okay, now we have to understand, see, the valves are basically made up of cusps, so they are like this. If we look at the top cross section view of this valve, it appear like this. So it is made up of basically three cusps, and hence it is known as a tricuspid valve, whereas if we look at this one, it is basically a bicuspid valve. It is into two chambers, and is having three chambers here. So if you look into it, the valves are like this, okay? So these valves are look like this, and hence it is known as the bicuspid valve, whereas here it is known as the tricuspid valve. So the valve separating the right auricle and the right ventricle is known as the right auriculoventricular tricuspid valve, and the valve separating the left auricle and the left ventricle is known as the left auriculoventricular, and is a bicuspid valve. Okay, so now we will look at the smaller, or rather the function of these valves. How do they function? Now across this, see if we go into this wall of the ventricular wall, we will see that there are certain ridges, okay? There are certain ridges which are long and certain ridges which are short. So again, here we have these long ridges and then they are short ridges, okay? So we have all throughout the ventricular wall, we will have these. So the longer ridges are known as papillary muscles, okay? So these longer ridges are known as, do we have some place here? Okay, these are known as papillary muscles, okay? These taller ridges basically are known as papillary ridges, and there are smaller ridges as well, and these are known as columnae corni, okay? So these are known as columnae corni, which is basically the smaller ridges. The taller ones are known as papillary muscles. So the all along the ventricular heart, there will be taller ridges which are known as papillary muscles, and the smaller ones are known as columnary corni, okay? Now what do these papillary muscles basically do? These papillary muscles are holding on to these walls by muscular structures which are known as coordinate tendini, okay? So we have these papillary muscles attached to these walls. So from here the papillary muscles will attach here. So whatever papillary muscles we will have here, we will attach here. Let's say this is also like this. So this is attached like this, okay? Some papillary muscles here would be attaching like this, okay? So these are basically papillary muscles, the longer ridges, and these jointed structures that we have are known as chordae tendini, okay? So these are basically known as chordae tendini. So chordae tendini are tough strands of connective tissues which are connecting the papillary muscles to these valves, okay? To these valves. So cusps basically are what? Thin flaps, and have to regulate the blood flow of chordae tendini are present in both the valves. So these chordae tendini are basically present in both the valves. So the bicuspid wall, the bicuspid wall is present between the left auricle and the left ventricle and allows unidirectional flow of oxygenated blood, which means that this wall will not allow the backflow of the blood. So it will allow oxygenated blood to flow from the left auricle to the left ventricle. Similarly, the tricuspid wall, which is present between the right auricle and the right ventricle, will allow blood to flow from right auricle to right ventricle only. Right auricle to right ventricle only. Now, how does this papillary muscles and chordae tendini help to prevent the backflow of blood? Now understand this. See, these are basically the flaps, okay? These are the papillary muscles and these are the chordae tendini. So what happens is, once the blood has come in, the ventricles will now contract. So the blood has come in, the ventricles, if they contract, and if this opens up like this, obviously the deoxygenated blood or whatever, the ventricular blood will go into this one again, okay? So in order to prevent that, the moment it happens, the papillary muscles contract, which means that these valves now close up, okay? So the papillary muscles contract, and this is basically tightening the chordae tendini, and that chordae tendini closes, okay? Which in turn prevents the valves from turning inside out. So they will not turn inside out. They will contract and the chordae tendini will tighten. These papillary muscles will contract, the chordae tendini will tighten, and the valves will close. So this prevents the blood from back flowing into the auricles, both the right auricle and the right left auricle as well. So being forced upwards during ventricular contraction. So ventricular contraction, as we know, is generated with a higher force, okay? As we have seen, the left ventricles is three times as strong or rather as thick as right ventricle, and again both the ventricles are far more thicker than the auricles. The purpose is contraction of blood, so obviously there is a huge force generated, and the moment it closes, there will be no backflow of blood. Okay, so papillary muscles contract, tightening the chordae tendini. So this chordae tendini in turn prevents the valves from turning inside out. This will not turn inside out, and during ventricular contraction it will be prevented, okay? So I hope this clarifies. So these taller ridges called papillary muscles are attached to chordae tendini to the valves, and they prevent the backflow of blood during ventricular contraction, which is very much necessary. So I hope this clears the portion of the valves and how they contract and how they actually function. Okay, so some more things about the human heart, as we have already covered a lot of portions out here. Now, what prevents the backflow of blood in the pulmonary vein? What actually prevents the backflow of blood in the pulmonary vein? We have seen that the pulmonary vein is carrying oxygenated blood through four blood vessels and pouring it into the left atrium, from where it obviously goes into the left ventricles, and from where it is pumped on to the entire body system. Now, again, as we saw in superior vena cava, the angle of the superior vena cava of entry was like this. The superior vena cava was entering like this. So obviously, when the auricles contract, it automatically closes. Okay, because of which there is no special requirement of any walls, and hence the same happens here as well. The angle with which they are entering the left atrium, when the left atrium contracts, it automatically closes, and hence it will prevent the backflow of blood. So there is no requirement of separate walls in the pulmonary veins. Okay, so pulmonary veins do not require any separate walls. Now let's talk about this. So the deoxygenated blood, which has come into the right ventricle, after it has come into the right auricle, it moves into the right ventricle. These walls open up and obviously it drains out here, and again as it comes here, it is ready to be pumped into the lungs. So these walls will now close. So we have seen what is the mechanism of caudate tendineae and the papillary muscles to close it. Okay, unidirectional flow of blood. Okay, so at the opening of pulmonary artery, walls like tricuspid or semilunar walls appear. So first let's see, because we will have to remove certain aspects here. So the pulmonary artery, lot of diagrams out here. So let's say we will rub all this off. Now we will draw the pulmonary artery, which is basically the blood vessel which emerges from here, and one part of it is going to the right lung and the other part of it is going to the left lung. Okay, let me So this is the pulmonary artery. This is the pulmonary artery which is carrying blood to the left and the right lungs. Okay, so this is basically the deoxygenated blood which is getting carried to the right and the left lungs. So the pulmonary artery, again there is a high chance of the backflow of the blood. So at the opening of the pulmonary artery, there are walls which are present, and these walls are also tricuspid walls, and they are known as semilunar walls. So the walls which are present between the atrium and the ventricle, these are also tricuspid, and the walls which are present here are also tricuspid. These are basically known as mitral walls. The walls which are present are also known as mitral walls between the auricular and the ventricles. So these are known as the mitral walls. Okay, and these are known as semilunar walls. Okay, so now what happens is, this is basically deoxygenated blood which enters here and is carried away all the way up to the through the pulmonary artery to the lungs. Okay, now what about the oxygenated blood? Once the oxygenated blood enters here, it is pumped into the left ventricle, and from the left ventricle it basically is carried to the main aorta. So we'll have to rub a lot of this because this is creating a mess. So let's look at this here. So here there will be an aorta, and this is how it is emerging. So let's rub this off as well. So this is the main aorta, and as we have seen, if you recall, this is the main aorta. If you recall, okay, in mammals, so this is the aorta. Let's say right here. This is basically the aorta part, and there are three basically chambers out here. There are three arcs, and this is how it goes. Okay, this supplies blood to the different parts of the body. So this is the main aorta. As we have seen in, if you recall, in birds and mammals, yes, we have this aorta, but in birds, it goes towards the right side. And in mammals, it goes towards the left side. That's the only difference between birds and mammals. So it goes towards the left side in mammals, and in birds, it goes towards the right side. Okay. So this aorta again, this aorta in mammalian heart, it goes to the left side, and it has three branches. And it has got three branches out here. These are three branches. Okay. And it is carrying again, this also will have valves to prevent the backflow, and these are also the same tricuspid valves, the same tricuspid lunar valves, semilunar valves basically, semilunar valves. These are tricuspid semilunar valves. Branches are the branchial artery, then we have the carotid artery and the subclavian artery. These three branches that we see here in the aorta, or the systemic arc, or the pulmonary arc. Okay, now if we recall in the earlier segment, we have studied that this is basically the heart wall. We have these muscles out here, okay, and this is basically the first layer. Then we have the myocardium, and then we have this is basically the endocardium, which is basically made up of single squamous epithelium. Then we have the myocardium, which is basically made up of a lot of cells, and then we have the endocardium. This endocardium, as we saw, is made up of a first inner layer, that is visceral layer, and the outer layer is known as the parietal layer, and in between is filled the pericardial fluid. So in between is filled the pericardial fluid. So if we look, this is basically what happens, the entire heart is like this. Okay, so we have the inner layer, which is basically the visceral layer, then we have the parietal layer, which is basically the outer layer. In between is filled the pericardial fluid. So this pericardial, so this runs across the heart. So this pericardial fluid basically acts as a lubricant and also acts as a shock absorber. So this was pretty much about the internal structure of the heart. We will go more into what are the differences between the mitral and the semilunar valves, and we will discuss that as well. Okay, so we have here the differences between the mitral and the semilunar valves. So we saw that semilunar valves are basically present at the base of pulmonary artery, and they are also present at the base of pulmonary artery, which is carrying blood to the lungs, and they are also present at the base of the aorta, which is carrying the blood to the different parts of the body to prevent the backflow. So these are tricuspid valves because they have three flaps, and mitral valves are also known as bicuspid valves. So if you look in between the right auricle and the right ventricle, we have the tricuspid valves. Whereas in between the left auricle and the left ventricle, we have the bicuspid valves, also known as the mitral valves. They have basically two flaps. So it guards the opening, the left atrioventricular space. It is present at the base of the pulmonary artery and the aorta at regular intervals in the veins. Okay. So it is present at the base of the pulmonary artery and the aorta, obviously, to prevent the backflow, and at regular intervals in the veins as well. Because in veins, this blood is basically deoxygenated blood, which is getting carried all the way up to the heart. So to prevent the, and mostly in veins, there is a anti-gravity movement. So in veins, we have anti-gravity movement, because of which there is a high risk. So let's say the blood from the foot is running all the way up to the heart. So it's an anti-gravity movement because there is a, it is going against gravity, and hence there's a high possibility of the backflow of the blood, and hence there are regular these tricuspid valves are there, which close. So present at the base of the pulmonary artery and aorta, of course, and at regular intervals in the veins, okay, to prevent the backflow of the deoxygenated blood. Now it allows the blood to move from the left auricle to the left ventricle. We have seen this, okay, and in the heart they allow the blood to flow from the ventricles to the get the arteries, and the veins. It allows the blood to flow towards the heart. So obviously it allows the blood to flow from the ventricles to the lungs as well as, okay, in the heart they allow the blood to flow from the ventricles to great arteries, and in the veins they allow the blood to flow from the flow towards the heart. So at one part they are allowing the blood to flow to the heart, the deoxygenated blood from the veins, and again they are allowing the blood to flow from the heart to the arteries as well. Okay, valves are attached to chordae tendineae, which prevent them from being averted out. So we have seen how the papillary muscles, which are present at the inner walls, are attached to the chordae tendineae and they prevent the backflow. Okay, valves are attached to the walls of the blood vessels. These are basically, so the, there are no chordae tendineae out here. The walls are like this, simple. Okay, they are attached to the walls of the blood vessels. No chordae tendineae are present. Here we need the chordae tendineae because ventricular contraction is a very forceful contraction, and if the chordae tendineae are not present, the walls will automatically open on the other way around. Okay, and that will make the deoxygenated blood or the blood from the ventricles to flow into the auricles, which should not happen. Okay, so hence we would need specialized papillary muscles as well as chordae tendineae to assist in the closure, proper closure of once the blood has come into the ventricle. Okay, here it will not, here it is just simply attached to the blood vessels. These walls are basically simply attached to the blood vessels, that is the veins. Okay, but here we would need the papillary muscles as well as the chordae tendineae to ensure that the backflow doesn't happen. Okay. Okay, so we will one second here. Okay, so we will discuss about the major blood vessels. Okay, major blood vessels, we all have now been aware that what are the blood vessels which are carrying blood to the heart and away from the heart. So superior and inferior vena cava basically pour the blood to the right atrium and the left atrium. To the right atrium, basically it is the superior and inferior vena cava are carrying deoxygenated blood from the upper and lower parts of the body and pouring into the right atrium. The left atrium receives oxygenated blood from the pulmonary veins. We have four sets of veins, two each from each of the left and right lungs. The right ventricle forces blood into the pulmonary artery. So the left, right ventricle forces blood into the pulmonary artery, which carries the deoxygenated blood into the lungs. Okay, now the left ventricle forces blood into the aorta. It basically forces the blood into the aorta that carries oxygenated blood to the whole body. So that's basically how the entire blood vessels is. Superior and inferior vena cava are carrying deoxygenated blood from the upper and lower parts of the body and pouring it into the right atrium. Okay, along with that we have the coronary sinus, which is basically pouring in deoxygenated blood from the heart wall into the heart itself. Okay, that is the right atrium. Now once the blood has entered from the deoxygenated blood which has entered the right ventricle, it is pumped into the lungs through pulmonary arteries. Okay, so pulmonary arteries are carrying the deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle into the lungs for oxygenation. Now let's come to the left atrium. So oxygenated blood by four sets of tubes from the that is the pulmonary veins from the lungs are carrying the oxygenated blood to the left atrium. From the left atrium, the oxygenated blood enters into the right ventricle. From the left ventricle, it is poured into the entire body through the through the main aorta. The left ventricle forces blood into the aorta or the systemic arc, whatever we want to call it, that carries oxygenated blood to the whole body. It is pumped to the whole body. So these are the major blood vessels that you need to remember, which are coming in and out of heart, which are basically either carrying in blood or carrying out blood. The ones which carry in blood are known as veins, and the ones which carry out blood from the heart are known as arteries. Okay, so that is the basic funda of naming the arteries and the veins. Now heartbeat we know is rhythmic. So heartbeat is basically rhythmically throughout the life. It happens throughout the life. It's a unique organ. Heart is basically a unique organ. It has stimulation to contract originating within itself. So it has a stimulation to contract originating within itself. So there is a stimulation to contract, there is an impulse to contract, and this originates within itself. In different animals, heartbeat originates differently. So in different animals, the heartbeats originate or happen differently, and accordingly the heart is called myogenic. The heart is called either myogenic or neurogenic depending upon how the heartbeat starts. So origin of heartbeat, if we look into it, the neurogenic heart is one in which the origin of heartbeat by specialized nerve fibers, and this is basically in invertebrates. Neurogenic heart is one in which the origin of heartbeat is by specialized nerve fibers, and these are known as, and this happens in invertebrates. Myogenic, origin of heartbeat by specialized group of muscle fibers, and these happen in vertebrates, that is in us. Okay, so heartbeat in itself is something which will happen from till death. Okay, so there is going to continuously happen, and this on the basis of this we can classify the animals as myogenic or neurogenic. Okay.